Okay, now the near-death experience, an out-of-body experience may be a part of the near-death.
That seems to be what the callers and persons who write to me have stated. Their out-of-body experience has been the result of an accident, or a, you know, an accident, of course, could be a drowning occurrence, something that would have otherwise caused them to no longer live. And then they recognize that. You're listening to Wings, New Age Forum. I am your host, Paul R. B. Horn. We have with us as our guest, Ken Eaglefeather, and certainly one of the most profound interest areas that we have, out-of-body experiences and out-of-body traveling tips given by Ken, and we shall return after this.
If you want to make sound investment decisions in today's volatile market, you need information. And now every month, Standard & Poor's Stock Guide will bring you information of a scope you've never seen before. This big, unique 268-page stock guide provides you with essential facts and figures on more than 5,000 listed and unlisted stocks. You'll find out about their earnings, prices, dividends, company products, over 40 revealing characteristics. The guide also covers mutual funds, feature articles, and much, much more. This is the famous stock guide many professional investors and brokers consider the information source, and over 375,000 smart investors turn to it every month. Now, you can use it as a solid foundation for your investment strategy. Yes, you can receive 6 months of Standard & Poor's Stock Guide for only $43, a real saving over the regular subscription price. Simply call this toll-free number, 1-800-826-2200. That's 1-800-826-2200 for Standard & Poor's Stock Guide. Send no money now. We'll bill you later.
Where will the next round of white-collar layoffs hit? According to a recent article in the Wall Street Journal, some of America's fastest-growing companies are re-examining their corporate structure and may eliminate a number of middle management positions. If you've been reading the Wall Street Journal, you would also know why it can pay to take a look at your credit report before you apply for a loan, and how amateur investors frequently outperform professionals. The Wall Street Journal, all the business news you need every business day in three time-saving sections.
Right now, you can get 13 weeks of the Journal for just $34. With your paid subscription, you'll also receive free a valuable 120-page guide to understanding money and markets. Call now, toll-free 1-800-228-3450. 13 weeks of the Journal and the 120-page guide, all for only $34. Today's Wall Street Journal. Faster, tougher, smarter. Call 800-228-3450 now.
You're listening to 1380 AM, KSWO, Lawton's public forum station, putting you in touch with America on the Sun Radio Network.
And you have returned to Wings. This is your host, Paul R. B. Horn. And we have with us this evening, Ken Eaglefeather, out-of-body traveling tips, and how to get out of the body and enjoy the experience, which, Ken, I'm certainly be a plus, because if it were the other way, it may not be too satisfactory. Let's go and explain what we were talking about just briefly.
In the near-death experience where the physical body undergoes a severe amount of trauma, taking you to the brink of death, there are certain features of that. Like, and one of those is the out-of-body. The person might go through a tunnel, meet a being or a field of light, might meet dead relatives, and might be sent back. The person might want to stay in this other arena, this other level of attention, but is sent back to fulfill some kind of purpose on the physical plane. And it's it can be a very religious experience indeed, and often there might be a mystical experience connotation to it, and mystical experiences cross-culturally, throughout all religions is the highest form of the religious experience. That's where concepts are let go, and my experience is a direct communion or union with the divine. And so that often plays a role in the near-death experience. Now, it is also possible to induce an out-of-body experience with lesser forms of trauma, such as severe fatigue, lots of stress, say job-related stress, or marital stress even, and the person will spontaneously have an out-of-body experience. Chances are it's still going to be a very positive experience.
Ken, now there are those who would ask you,
Couldn't this, in fact, be a form of hallucinating if you're under a great deal of stress or under a great deal of fatigue?
That's a legitimate concern. The response is that when you have an out-of-body experience, there is no doubt in your mind that it is not an hallucination and it is not a dream. If I may, for just a minute, go back to my working definition of an out-of-body experience. The first one being that consciousness is localized away from the physical body. It is not as though you are in your physical body perceiving yourself at a distance. It is yourself at a distance perceiving your physical body. The second one...
Run that. Let's go through that again. That was a little quick. Let's really go through that one more time because that's very pertinent.
All right. And a lot of times, say, for example, in otoscopy, a person will perceive themselves at a distance. They might be sitting in their sofa chair in their living room.
A defined otoscopy.
Let me get it to you by this analogy.
All right.
It literally means seeing yourself.
All right.
If you broke the camera. And so if you were sitting in your chair, yourself at home, and you looked up and you saw a replica of yourself, something like a mirror image standing in the hallway.
A clone.
And a man who speaks, yes,
okay,
a clone.
Fine.
But the reference point is always you in your physical body as you are normally aware of it, perceiving this other clone, whatever it is. Now, in an out-of-body experience, consciousness is localized away from the physical body. The point of reference, the perception, shifts dramatically, unalterably, unquestionably, from the physical body to another location, to where if you were having an out-of-body experience and you were looking back at your physical body, it would be from the point of reference of the hallway looking at the physical body sitting in the chair of the sofa.
All right, okay, I see that.
The second one is this body has form of some kind. The form could be a replica of your physical body, meaning you have an arm, head, leg, torso. It could be as a sphere of light, or it could be as a blob of jello, as one woman put it. She called it a blob of clear jello. But it has form, some kind of form. It really doesn't matter what.
And this is typically you yourself, or your spirit form.
It's both. It is you yourself, and it is you your spirit form.
If that can be, if they can be divided, are they at one?
They are both at one and different, depending upon how you look at them. Depending upon what frame of reference you're coming from at the moment.
Let's go back to this hallucinating theory again. I recall having, military experience that intensified your emotions and reactions, intensified your reactions to a level that's almost unreal.
Mm-hmm.
That the reaction time is instinctive. You've gone beyond the point of the tiredness and whatever else you may have been involved with, and I don't want to go into a great deal of detail, but that specific circumstance is that you are intense and everything is magnified and you're instinctively reacting. Yet, even though the things around you are happening, you still... And I'm not certain that hallucinating is the proper word for it. You're under a great deal of stress, and things may not seem as they are. Now, that's what I would think in terms of hallucinating, in terms of things are not as they seem.
In out-of-body experience, things are as they seem.
Okay, there's the difference.
And the hallucination might be the harbinger, the beginning point of an out-of-body experience. Things are still in a state of flux. There is no meaning, there is no context of the experience. And even if a person has never run across this idea of an out-of-body experience before, if they are having one, it has meaning to them. They might not be able to define it, but there's not going to be that flux of a hallucination. It's going to be the experience is going to have a lot of integrity. It's going to have
All right, good word, integrity. It's not something that's a happenstance.
No.
It's a developmental situation. In other words, I'm not reacting as a result of stress.